Hello, everybody. Welcome to Cape Rugby TV. It's Wednesday night. So, of course, 9 o'clock and the very best of Cape Rugby as we normally do on a Wednesday. On the show with me this evening, Ishmael Dolly. Hello, Ish.
Hi, JP. Good to be back on the show.
Jerome Paardvater, Head of Talent Identification. Hello, Jerome.
Hello, JP. Yeah, good to be back. And was an exciting week of rugby pass, so it's good to be back.
Yeah, we're going to talk about some very, very big games and, of course, some interesting fixtures that are coming up. And then we're going to talk a little bit about the fact that there's a bit of a break. But we're not going to take a break, that's for sure. Remember, some big competitions coming up during the course of the show as well. Hisense is, of course, the official technical partner to Cape Rugby TV. A little bit later in the show, we'll announce last week's Hisense Infinity Pulse winner. Remember, you can win yourself a Hisense Infinity Pulse cell phone. All you need to do is go to our Facebook page. We'll tell you more about that a little bit later. Score Energy Drinks, as you see the logo behind me now. Score Energy Drinks on board with Cape Rugby, and you'll have a chance to win a case of Score. And, of course, Factory Shops SA mobile app, one of our keen supporters here at Cape Rugby TV. Download the Factory Shops SA mobile app. Very helpful. And not to forget the fact that, of course, Best Med will be helping us with the Best Med feature during the course of the show. That comes a little bit later. The West Bromwich Rugby School of Excellence Best Med feature. All right. Of course, the feature game of the weekend was False Bay against Hamilton's. It was a top-of-the-table clash. There certainly wasn't any other game to go to that was at that level. And we went down to False Bay to go and watch these two monster teams take on each other. Let's have a look. Right, folks, I'm going to say absolutely nothing. Ishmael Dolly, you saw the first half. Your thoughts?
Wow, the intensity looked very, very quick. The physicality, it's just on another level. And a lot of clubs won't be able to compete at that level, week in and week out. So credit to that first half. It'll be interesting to see that second half.
Yeah, Jerome, jy glimlach so breed. Jy glimlach so a happy VP coach.
Yeah, JP, I mean, it's good to see. It's good to see the intensity of the game. And it's good to see the execution of the guys. If you look at the passes, the handling, I mean, that's top class. And if you look at the defense there, I mean, in any other game, Jody Birch would have scored there under the poles. But he's got a double hit there, and you could see the guys are doing their work on defense. And it's just the attitude and how the guys were playing it. That first half, as we see now, it's a different level. It's, if you look at the Currie Cup now, JP, you can almost say it's like how the guys are doing in the Currie Cup now. So it's good to see that, and that's why we blessed in Western Province with the talent that we have in the rugby that the guys are playing. And I mean, also if you look at the refereeing, you can look at everything. It's top quality.
Well, we spoke about this last week. We said it was going to be impossible to call all the stats. Everything pointed at an absolutely equal playing field, and it literally was, including the score at halftime. That was 12-all. All right, folks, we're going to get you through to the second half now. Let's catch up now with the second half. False Bay against Hamilton's. The game continues, and we'll ask our expert panel members to give us their further analysis in a second or so. Let's check out the second half. False Bay against Hamilton's. All right, folks, there you see it, the highlights, False Bay against Hamilton's. All right, I'll throw it back at the panel, Ish.
Action-packed. I think 24 with 15 minutes to go, I think not one side wanting to give in. And I think with the deadly boot of Monty keeping them in the game, and False Bay's front pack giving them that go-forward ball from scrums, I think that sort of equaled each other out.
Yeah.
But I think it maybe just came down to decision-making on the day. You know, that small decisions that can go either way from your key decision makers could have actually made the difference in the end.
Yeah, Jerome, your feelings?
Yeah, it was pretty much a battle up front, and False Bay were the strongest pack on the scrumming wise with Ashley Wells and the other front row experienced guys. And it was a balance, and Hamilton's were good in the lineouts. The execution was good from the lineouts, but scrumming wise, False Bay took them on at scrum time. Hamilton's were a little bit better in the lineouts, so it balances out. But it's just amazing to see the quality and the possession the guys get and how and what they do with the ball. You could see it's the execution, it's planned moves, and it's not just running rugby or it's everything. You can see what they want to do, where they are on the field, and maybe at the end there falls by a little bit of patience. Could have played at that time, would say normally teams, if it's so close, try to play for a penalty or try to set it up and maybe a drop goal or so. So I just think, at the end of the day, I think that's a great result because it's almost like a true reflection of the game.
You know, one of the things that we've been saying during the season is that most club rugby games, you maximum will get 50, 60 minutes out of your team. You don't get an 80-minute game in club rugby. Ish, I must say, this is about as close as I came. In fact, it looked like an 80-minute game.
I think what you can take out of these two clubs is that these players are conditioned. These guys are on nutritional programs. These guys have access to world-class facility gyms. So it's to be expected, you know, coming from two of these top clubs in the Western Cape. And it's for no uncertain reason that these two are the top two clubs in the Super A. And it's credit to them that they've utilized and maximized the opportunities that they have. And if we can only get more, you know, access to facilities to many other clubs out there, we could get more games like these.
Yeah. Right, folks, we managed to catch up with the first coach. Of course, no losing coach, no winning coach. Anton Wilman, first up. He's, of course, head coach at Hamilton's. Folks, with me now, Anton Wilman is the head coach at Hamilton's. Mully's monster game, equal all the way through.
Yeah, obviously a big top of the table clash. You know, 24, so it's like kissing your sister. Yeah. But, you know, we're away from home today. False Bay are a great side. They've really developed over the last 3 years and they've got a good culture. And, you know, I thought 24 all at the end of the day was probably a fair reflection.
Yeah. The game went well over overtime, I think maybe 3 minutes odd. There were some opportunities for both sides again to make a. To put something on the board, but again, it was just equal even in the overtime.
No, you know, look, at that stage, none of us were trailing. It was 24, so yeah. You know, it was game one for everybody to turn that result around. But I thought, you know, both sides showed a lot of gumption on defence, and I think the attitudes were fantastic. We defended probably the majority of that that final stage. Unfortunately, you know, we had the wind behind our backs, and we managed to keep them on the halfway line out of range. So yeah, I mean, happy for my boys to go home. You know, we both move up the log. We level on 36 points, I think it is. And, you know, we've got big games to come in the second round. So we've just got to pick ourselves up from here, take the positives and look forward. We've got one more game left before the break.
So you've got one more game and then, of course, it's the break. During the break itself, plans?
Yeah, you know, look, I think it's quite a long one. I think we've got a five-week break. So we've got one or two runs planned, but we'll definitely take down the load, give the boys a week or so off, and then come back and start building because we've got big games after the break as well. And I think all the top sides are going to be playing each other, so there's going to be some interesting position swapping in July.
But I suppose. Get a bit of ice on the joints and the muscles. A bit of recovery also will take priority.
Oh, absolutely, the boys deserve a break. They've trained really hard, and you know, fortunately, we don't have that many injuries. Let's hope that it carries through until after Durbanville next week, and then I can give the boys a good rest and get a strong squad back to face the balance of the season.
Well, as we leave it at that, congratulations, both sides. Fantastic game, incredible rugby. This is exactly what we're looking for in the world of Western Bronx Club Rugby. I think you guys can really hold your heads high.
Oh, thanks very much, sir. Cheers.
Well, I think you can see Anton Wilman really has the ability to stabilize the team there, Jerome. He's been there a very long, long time. He's part of the furniture. Yeah. But, you know, he knows how to get the best out of Hamilton.
Yeah, I mean, Anton's quite an experienced coach. I think he's more than 10 years now at the club. And he's one of the coaches who stays the longer in the club. With his experience, and he always managed to get a good squad going. And he knows his business, and Yeah, and it's also, that's one of the reasons why our club rugby are up there, because we've got quality coaches also.
Yeah. Ish, it helps to have stability in your coaching.
Correct.
I know you want, teams will sometimes say, well, we got third place this year, we want to win it, so let's change the coach. Or we're new, so let's change the coach. But sometimes that can cost you.
Absolutely, and I think credit to Hamilton's management for sticking with the coaching staff, as with Anton over the past couple of years. And he has produced consistent results, let's be honest, over the past 10 years.
Which is all you want.
Absolutely, and why change when things are going well?
Yeah.
And I mean, Anton has been involved with, he was with the coaching staff with the Vodacom team in 2006, 2005. So he comes with a bit of experience, and he's also head of the Western Province Rugby Academy, if I'm not correct. And that experience, you know, he picks up and he's been around. So players feed off his knowledge, and he's very good at giving it back to them as well.
All right, talking about consistency, Jody Birch is, of course, the captain at Hamilton's. We've had him on the show before. He's certainly leading from the front, as you saw with some of the monster drives that he is known for. Let's catch up now with, again, I can't say the winning coach, captain, or the losing captain, but Jody Birch. Folks, with me now is Jody Birch. He's the captain at Hamilton's. Jody, what a game. Hamilton's False Bay, it was a real spectacle for club rugby fans today.
Yes, definitely. It's always a big game. I think it's become a local derby, you know, between the two sides that are always competing for the league. And, you know, unfortunately, there was no winner today. But that's rugby. I think we definitely impressed the crowd. I think both teams played in spells. And, yeah, you know, wish there was a winner, but that's how rugby goes.
There are almost no parts that I could say any team won or lost it. It looked like everything was so equally matched, and it reflects in the score as well.
No, definitely. Listen, you know, we knew that their mauls would be a problem if we could target their lineout. So, you know, they targeted our ruck time and we targeted theirs. So it was, yeah, it was tit for tat. And it was just, you know, whatever team broke first, you know, would have been the loser. But, you know, both teams, credit to both teams for sticking to it. It was a physical game. You know, I think there'll be a lot of sore bodies tomorrow. But yeah, you know, it was enjoyable, and that's what club rugby in the Western Cape's all about. So, you know, I mean, I'm just happy for that.
Jody, we'll leave it at that. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Special game.
Thank you.
Right, folks, of course, the captain of Hamilton's, Jody Birch, an absolute gentleman. Always fantastic to talk to him on Cape Rugby TV. Remember, you can win yourself a Hisense Infinity Pulse cell phone. All you need to do is go to our Facebook page and tell us who is the official technical partner to Cape Rugby TV, and you can win yourself a KitKat Android 4.4 Hisense Infinity Pulse, a cell phone with a 5-inch multi-touch screen, a 4G LTE dual SIM, and an 8-megapixel rear camera with LED flash and front 5-megapixel camera. Just go to our Facebook page and tell us who is the official technical partner to Cape Rugby TV. A little bit later in the show, we'll give you an opportunity to win yourself a case of Score energy drinks. And we'll also tell you more about Factory Shops SA, a mobile app. We'll be back after the ad break. Welcome back, everybody. Yes, it's Cape Rugby TV, and it was a fantastic game over the weekend with two teams that we went to watch, Hamilton's against False Bay. And as we said last week, it was impossible to pick the winners or losers. We now catch up with the coach of False Bay, Jono van der Walt. He's been on the show with us before, and of course has also now been appointed as the coach of the emerging team. Let's speak to Jono. Folks, with me now is Jono van der Walt. Jono, fantastic game.
Yeah, JP, a cracker. We knew it was going to be tough when it came down to this, and much like last year, it was also tough. Both teams coming in unbeaten, and it's a draw. It's not the result that both teams wanted, but I suppose it's rugby. At the end of the day, it was a machine game here with a lot of spectators, and it came down to the wire. It went to and fro in the last 5 or 6 minutes. Could have been any team's result on the day. So.
That's exactly what everybody's been saying. They've been saying Hamilton's Bay are the teams to watch. The stats are equal for both sides. And nobody could call it. I mean, you can't expect better from the world of club rugby.
This league is tough, and There's no such thing as big teams and small teams every single week. You know, like we say, it's a marathon, not a sprint. Yeah. And you've got to pick yourself up every single week. This was our ninth game, so we've had nine in a row. We get to enjoy a six-week break now, and then we have five games after the break.
John, we're going to leave it at that. Before you go, we must just say congratulations on your position as the coach of the emerging side. I'm sure you're very excited about that.
Yes, JP, very excited and very happy, obviously, for the recognition. But again, you know, like I've mentioned before, it's not just me. I have an awesome team and an awesome squad, and very good coaching staff as well. So, but it's been nice, and I look forward to the challenge.
John, we're going to leave it at that. I'm sure you've got a lot of people to get to talk to. Of course, you guys, home ground today, fantastic venue, thousands of fans, and I'm sure the boys are cold and in the change room and waiting for you now.
Definitely a little beer waiting for me there, JP.
We'll leave it at John. Thanks for chatting with us.
Here we go. Thanks.
All right, John van der Velde with False Bay again. Been with False Bay a while now, maybe not as long as Anton Wilman and Hamilton's. But it just, again, it goes to show the consistency in the coaching. I can see, Jerome, I can see why he's been selected as the emerging team coach.
Yeah, definitely, JP. And it's also a good opportunity for him to make a bit of a step up, to get involved with the province team. And that is one of the reasons. You can see what his club is doing and what he's doing. And he's a young coach also.
Yeah.
And it's a bit of a reward for him. But he is really a good coach. He's a student of the game also. He puts a lot of effort. And he's also one of that coaches who's not afraid to ask if he needs help.
Is he head coach, assistant coach? How does that? Just give us a rundown of the emerging team structures. Aren't you also one of the coaches?
Yeah.
Jerome, are you the head coach?
No. Jonathan is the head coach. Is assistant coach. And Wilbur Krak is the one assistant coach.
Yes.
And Dion Isaacs is the manager of the squad.
All right, okay. Yeah. So, Ish, are you backlining or tell us about it?
We're having our first meeting in the week coming up. So we're going to be getting together as a coaching staff for the first time, and we'll share ideas and see where responsibilities and job descriptions fits in.
New world for John, though, eh?
No, I think he's got the credibility in terms of the record that he's had with False Bay. And False Bay's come up from the lower leagues, and they've done extremely well over the past couple of years.
I mean, you had these challenges yourself. I mean,
absolutely.
When you got first appointed into emerging squad coach, it's different from where you know all the players. Now you've got a combination of players.
Absolutely, and you're dealing with players from all different clubs. So, yeah. And this year there will be a different breed of new players. You just saw that the amount of players that are coming into Western Province. We are blessed with so many talents. It's important for us to nurture that and bring the best out of them.
All right, folks. Of course, the captain at False Bay, Graham Knoop. Now, he's been around for a while as well. Also, one of the emerging. I think he played for the emerging team. He played overseas. I think he might have played for Ulster.
Played Vodacom.
Played in the Vodacom Cup team. So, very experienced player. He played at UCT as well.
Mm-hmm.
So, otherwise known as Snoopy. Snoop Dog. Or Snoop. Let's catch up with Graham Knoop. Massive game today.
Yeah, it was a big game. I think we all knew it would be a big game. We knew it would be tight as well. And both teams rocked up and delivered. And I think if the result shows is that it was a crack of a game.
Fans came out here in their droves. It looks like the Bay is having an absolute jaw this year.
Yeah, I think it's great for the Bay. I think it's also great for club rugby. Guys can come down and grab a beer or Coke and a Brewballs roll and come down and watch club rugby. And it's exciting too. And I think it's good for club rugby.
Your feeling on the league so far? Couple of good teams out there.
Yeah, massive. I think anything that you can learn from the league and the results as far is that any team can turn anyone on the day. It's not a top tier, a bottom tier league. You've got to have your wits about you and make sure that you rock up for every weekend.
Next game for you guys?
We've got 6 weeks break off now, and then I think we're coming up against Marty's. So that should be a good one.
Going to be interesting.
Yeah, it will be.
So we'll catch you guys on the flip side. Thank you very much.
Cheers. Thanks, JP.
Graham Knoops, Snoopy, leading the way at False Bay, not only on the field, but also off the field. The off-field initiatives that the club is coming up with are absolutely admirable. And that's what we want to see from a club that entertains the visitors. That was beautiful, beautiful to watch the Hamilton's guys stick around the club and really have a jol with the False Bay guys. And Jerome, this is what you want, huh?
Yeah, definitely, JP. It's and I think it's going, people will call it old school, where you had that after-match functions, where guys get to know each other better after a game, have a beer or cool drink together. And I mean, it's like, I don't want to talk about the days that I've played, but
we don't have the black and white footage.
There's still guys that I've played against because we've talk after the game and drink a beer afterwards, talk. And I think more and more clubs are going back to that, which is good. So guys start to know each other. Yeah. And you never know what you can always
need
somebody.
But it's more than this. It wasn't just the aftermatch function. In fact, there were no players at the aftermatch function. The aftermatch function was for the administrators. They were there shaking hands. You know, the executive of the club shaking hands, whatever. The teams had split themselves away and were doing their own thing as players, involving themselves with their own fine session and chat session, which is that's different. That I haven't seen that before. And the False Bay, you know, we've spoken over the years about the kind of things that clubs must do, from jumping castles, social media, Facebook, and so on. And it's interesting to see how some of the clubs have adopted a whole new approach. I look at Tigerberg, for example. Tigerberg put out a Facebook post with a press release the other day about fan behavior, which
admirable.
Now, yes, as a media spin doctor, I wouldn't necessarily say that's the best thing to do, but what they did do in that process was show their intention for good, clean rugby. So that's something we don't see clubs do often either. We saw False Bay with a different call it entertainment activity for their guests. We see Elsie's Refuge doing their type of thing. We get a militant, and it's a very much a corporate social media, a corporate social investment drive. Everybody seems to be taking a new leap. We've built the foundations, but now you guys are coming with your own creative ways of, it's becoming more interesting.
I think clubs are sort of adapting to what's uniquely suited to their needs and what the sort of club capacity can handle, and then try and maximize it. To get as much revenue out of it, to get as much exposure, to get as much fan engagement within it. And that's what it comes down to. I think the fan engagement and building that social networks, because you'll notice that when teams socialize after the games, you don't maybe know that maybe that guy is into a certain business that might have an interest in you or your brother or your sister. And that's where
most of the time it's in your sister. You know, most of the time it's not an interest. Right, folks, one of the other dilemmas that we had on the day was, because it was 24 all in, was such a brilliant game, there was just no ways that we could choose only one man of the match. So we went a step further this week, and we asked Evox Advanced Nutrition, who is of course the official sports nutrition supplier to Western Bronze Rugby and the Stormers, and is available to all club rugby players, to donate two products on the day. The first man of the match was from Hamilton's, and there was of course Patrick O'Brien. He plays flank for Hamilton's, our first man of the match. Folks, with me now, the Evox Advanced Nutrition Man of the Match from Hamilton's. And of course, today we're giving two Man of the Match prizes because of the equal game. Patrick O'Brien playing flank at Hammies. Patrick, you win a rapid recovery courtesy of Evox Advanced Nutrition. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Great game.
Yeah, it was a tough one. Yep. Not the result we wanted, but you know, when two giants crash, it's the glorious that takes a bit of a hammering, and that's what happened today. 24-all. I think all teams gave it their all. It wasn't the result we wanted, but we'll take it.
Yeah, your own game, considering that you are the man of the match, it looked like you were leading from the front there.
Yeah, I enjoy the carries, I enjoy the physical stuff, you know, and that's all part of the game. You give me the ball anytime, or let them run straight onto me anytime, I'll take it.
All right, Pat, we'll leave it there. Congratulations once again. You are the Evox man of the match.
Thank you so much.
All right, so congratulations then to Patrick. Jerome, good flank?
Yeah, very good player. He He should have stayed in Western Province. I'm glad to see that he's back. He went to Pumas and things didn't work out for him there. So it's good to have him back here, and he's playing good rugby. I saw him against Tigerberg, and I mean Saturday also, obviously man of the match. So it's good that Patrick is back in Cape Town again.
All right, another Evox Advanced Nutrition Man of the Match. But now, of course, on the day we only had one prize, which we gave to Patrick, and he disappeared. We wanted to show it again. So Ryan Woolifier, otherwise I think his nickname is Flace, and you would have seen him with some of those barge-storming runs, or barn-storming runs at least. He plays eighth man at False Bay. He was our False Bay Man of the Match. So, Ryan, yes, we know we're still going to have to get you your Evox Rapid Recovery, and that'll be on its way to you soon. But congratulations on your performance. Let's catch up now with Ryan Woolifier, the False Bay's Man of the Match.
Right, folks, no stranger to Cape Rugby TV, Ryan Woolifier. Ryan is the Evox Advanced Nutrition False Bay Man of the Match. Incredible game today. You left your body on the line again. We've seen it time and time again. You must be very happy with your performance.
Yeah, it's been a lekker day. It's always a good derby game. We knew it was going to be physical, so we had to bring it for the day. So enjoyed it. It's lekker.
You walk away with a tub of Rapid Recovery. We weren't expecting to do two Man of the Matches today. Patrick O'Brien from Hamilton's won the Man of the Match there. It looks like you guys were very equally matched today.
Yeah, we knew, like, they've got a big pack, so up front we had to man up. That's just the way it is. They came at us at times, and yellow card, two tries, so, but we had to step it up, and we got a draw with it, so 2 points each. That's what you're going to have to do.
Oh, well done. It was a fantastic game. Thanks, Ryan, we'll leave it at that, my man. Hopefully you get a little bit of ice and a cold one after this.
Thanks, man.
Here we go, folks. Flace, Ryan, congratulations. He's, of course, played in, I think, emerging side.
Yeah, he was the captain last year of the emerging side, and he also last year played Vodacom Cup. He was in the Curry Cup squad also early on this year.
Played with you then, Nervous.
Yeah, very good player. Leads by example, and obviously he's got a good tactical brain on him as well.
Yeah, I think he is the one player that, after every game, if I have to look for a player that's possibly concussed, then it's him. He leaves his body on the line. He leaves nothing behind.
Absolutely, and you know, you need that from a leader. You know, he leads from the front, and his actions actually speak louder than his words.
Yeah.
And the players follow him. He literally puts his body on the line week in and week out.
Yeah. All right, folks, as we said earlier on, if you want to win yourself a case of Score energy drinks, and all you need to do is SMS the word SCORE to 33280, SCORE to 33280. A little bit later in the show, we're going to announce last week's winner of the Score energy drink. So we hope that you got your cell phones handy. 33280, SMS the word SCORE, and you can put yourself in line to win a case of Score energy drinks. We'll take an ad break, and when we come back, we'll start taking a look at the rest of the results in a Super League game. Here we go, folks. Right, it's Cape Rugby TV. Remember, you can find us on Facebook and on Twitter at Cape Rugby TV, and on Facebook, www.facebook.com/CapeRugbyTV. Share your stories. The more you share, the more we can air. We're loving getting your posters in. People often ask, oh, how do I get onto Cape Rugby TV? Or why don't you share our poster? Well, a good idea is to first make a poster and put it up. And we'll be happy to publish your stories. Okay, let's take a look at some of the other results in Super League 8. It was Brackenfell with a win over Primrose, 45 points to 29. False Bay, as you saw, 24 all against Hamilton's. SK Wormers went down to Tiger with 34 points to 20, while UWC beat NNK 38-23. Solarians went down to Durbel, 58-17. Gentlemen, let's quickly zone in on a few of those results there. Brackenfell with a 45-29 win over Primrose. Brackenfell-ish, we know they've been playing good rugby.
Very impressive. For a team that came up from Super B, they are doing exceptionally well. Sitting nicely in the middle of the table, got 5 wins under their belt. I think they've done really well. I think they've kind of secured their position in this league. I think one or two more wins will definitely seal it for them. So they've done exceptionally well.
Well, I'm just looking across at our stats screen now that folks can't see, but so if you're wondering why my eyeballs are going off the camera, Brackenfell nevertheless are going to have to stay on top of things because they have played 9 games already. And a number of the other games below them, teams have got quite a lot of games in hand. UWC has only played 6, Stellenbosch has only played 5. Not below them.
Well, the great thing is that they've collected 5 wins.
Yeah.
And I mean, those teams still have to play to win. And so they can go into this break knowing that, listen, yeah, we've got the points. After this 7-week period, we'll have an understanding in terms of what we need to achieve, in terms of what have the other teams done. Have they caught up? Have they not? And that's a great position to be.
All right. And the other win then was Tigerberg 34-20 over SK Warmers. Tigerberg now sitting number 3 on the log. Played 9 games. They've won 6. They've lost 2. They've drawn 1. We would have probably said, people asked me at the game, who do they think could possibly upset Marties going further in the year? And I don't remember if Tigerberg played against Marties or not, but Tigerberg can be a dark horse, and if there's a team that can pull a rabbit out the hat, it might be Tigerberg.
Yeah, definitely, JP. I mean, Tigerberg, last week they were a bit unhappy not to take the win there against, they had the opportunities right at the end, which the kicker missed against Hamilton's. So, I mean, they're not afraid of the bigger teams, and I saw them last year against Marty's, also unlucky not to win that game last year. So I think where they are on the table, it's also good, and the work that they put in also good. And I mean, I would have expected a very hard and physical game on Saturday also. But I just think that at the end of the day, the discipline costs SK again. SK is also a team, very good team, but they need to sort their discipline out because no team can play with 12 or 13 players.
Oh, were there a lot of cards in the game? Yeah. I don't know. Did you watch the game?
Yeah, off the ball.
You were probably busy.
Off the ball. Off the ball. Unnecessary stuff that doesn't belong in rugby anymore. And I was so proud of them watching them against Durbel, and very good game, played in a good spirit, and I just think they must get their act together. And you can't, like, every second week then something's wrong. They must look at themselves now, and we here to play decent rugby. They can play decent rugby, and they must sort their discipline out.
At the end of the day, you can't play on the field with 12, 13. You can't play with less men.
I think they were in that game, according to reports, even with 13 men. And if they were just maybe with the full quota of players, it could have been a different story. But I think credit to Tigerberg, they've been well drilled by Ricky and Brandt.
Yeah.
And they certainly on a very, very good wicket in terms of their culture, their chaos, their vibe.
No, that's a good thing.
And they've done really well to stand in a very good position on the log.
All right, the other team, UWC, they pulled it off over NNK. We were a little bit 50-50 on where that was going to go. And then Durbel with a big win over Solarians, 58 points to 17. If we just look at some of the stats there, we're looking... James, we're not going to put this up on the screen now, but one of the questions, if we look at the stats, if we look at the average points here at the moment, average points per game, right now, Marty's is scoring the most per game. They're scoring 43 points per game, but the next up is False Bay Hamilton's with a 38 and a 36 and a 33. I don't know how many teams look at this, but to score that many points in a game, would we say, Jerome, that this is about average for club rugby? A plus, we're talking about the top 6 teams now are scoring plus 35 to 40 points per game.
I think we also got to look at who those teams played. So if those top 6 teams have played mostly the bottom 6 or the bottom 8, it can have a skewed advantage or look at the way the average points are scored. If they were playing maybe each other, the average points maybe would have been at a lower percentage. So that also can, I mean, stats can sometimes lie, but Marty's obviously, they've played the least amount of games, 6, and they've got the highest points average. So we must also take that into account when looking at that.
All right, folks, we're going to take an ad break, and when we come back, we'll take a look at some of the results in Super League B. Right then, welcome back everybody. It's time for us to take a look at the Super League B fixtures. But before I do that, let's quickly announce last week's winner of the Hisense Infinity Pulse competition. And as I said earlier on, you can win yourself that Hisense Infinity Pulse simply by going to Facebook and telling us who is the official technical partner. And that puts you in the draw to win yourself a 55-inch smart TV. So congratulations then to last week's winner, Jody Lee Mentor. Jody walks away with a Hisense Infinity Pulse cell phone and also goes into the draw to win the 55-inch smart TV. So congratulations, Jody, one of the boys from Cat Rugby TV. Got to get in touch with you to make sure that you get your Hisense Infinity Pulse cell phone ready for collections. Great phone. Right, folks, let's quickly take a look at the results in Super League B now. Helderberg, it was a 21-12 win for Helderberg over... At least for young peoples over Helderberg. Belleville beat Strand 31-10. Kraaifontein lost to Violets. Pernille Villagers 40-10 over Goodwood. St. George's went down to Villagers. Collegians beat Hands and Hearts, and then Union Mill beat Hamlets. Okay, a couple of standout games there. A good win for Pernille Villagers, I would say. If we look at the Pernille Villagers, they're third on the log at the moment. They've played seven games, they've won six. So again, also up in the ranks there. Ish, you guys, Milton played against Hamlets. You beat them convincingly, 38-7. But Hamlets are still on top of the log, although you, Milton, Pernille Villagers have got two games in hand. So it's not a foregone conclusion. Still not a big gap.
Not a big gap. It was a good game on Saturday. Hamlets, really, they bring the they bring the crowd, they bring the gears, they bring the vibe.
Bring the fans.
Absolutely, and they brought a massive band as well, you know. So they play a really good brand of rugby, and the support following from the community is great.
Yeah.
And Kevin Passons has done an amazing job just in terms of turning that club around. And I mean, they're sitting at the top of the table.
Yeah, let's take a look at the results now in the Super League C. And there we see Hamadiers with a loss to Young Stars. Silverleaf went down to Raithby. Langa 25-23 over Masi Pumalele. Elsies beat Blues Edge. Franschhoek United went down to Rangers. Lagunya went down to Cullamore. And Paul beat Scottsdene 36-17. While in the City League, it was a win for Busy Bees and a win for Silver Tree. In the Southern League, a win for Thistles. It was a win for Young Wesleys. Yesterday, Richmond Rangers, I believe that game was called off after Richmond Rangers apparently didn't feel the side. That to be confirmed. And then Noordlikers, we're not really sure what happened there as Noordlikers take the 5 points. In the Northern League, Stelcor went down to All Saints. It was a massive win for Blakes. They bounced back against Delft. Thunderstar with a win over Khayelitsha. Blue Stars beat Atlantis and Vineyards with an 89-0 win over Strand Pioneers. In the Par League, it was a win for Young Standards, a win for Allendale, a win for Simondium, and a win for Albions. Right, folks, those are your results in the leagues, the Western Province leagues. We'll take a look at some of the fixtures in a minute or so. In the meantime, it is the Western Province Rugby School of Excellence happening at the moment. The teams have been selected. BestMed has come on board with Western Province Rugby and is sponsoring the Western Province Rugby School of Excellence. The kids have now been selected. And on Monday, they went out to the High Performance Center, of course, which would have been lovely for the boys, where they did their fitting. Now, it's not often that we see how the jerseys and the kit is selected for provincial players. This time, we went to take a look.
The following Western Province Rugby School of Excellence insert is brought to you by BestMed. Be active, be safe, be happy, be NutriWise, be fin fit.
My involvement with the team is basically from an administrative point of view to ensure that all the administrative duties are done for the Western Province trials. For today, we are at Belleville High School. We're doing a fitting for our under 18 and under 16 training squad. We'll be participating in Oudtshoorn on the 16th of June and 17th of June in Oudtshoorn and George. So today we're doing a kit fitting for the provincial tournament. Basically, I bring my kit, which comprises of a Western Province DHL jersey, which they get, a plain short, which they will play in with a new design of the pant, a tracksuit, which comprises of the top, which is a light jacket, and a tracksuit pants as well.
Today's fitting clothes, always a part and parcel of any team. And then after that, the practice. It's in 2 weeks' time we're going to the Coastal. Quite a big tournament just to get everything sorted and, you know, finalize the teams. Coming together certain days, practice, give them off again, and then go a bit earlier to Durban, say 2-3 days, and then have a bit of a camp there, and then we're in the grain week. Yeah, it's the final squad, but we're about 46 boys, actually a bit more. And then out of that 46 we'll announce the final teams for the Craven Week and the academy side. So I think there's a lot of talent. Western Province always got talent. Just to utilize that talent is quite important. Looking forward to this year.
You know, getting all the kits sorted out, and then we're going straight into some defense and attacking play. And after the Coastal tournament, we're playing Southwestern Districts and also the Eastern Province. And once we've finished playing them there, we'll decide on the A and B team and the under 16 age group that will represent Western Province at Grand Coma. We want to make sure that the boys last and be able to represent Western Province not only at under 18, but also one day at Super Rugby. So we've got to make sure that we look after them, and that's why we've got really good conditioning coaches that are sort of here to make sure that the guys are warmed up properly and obviously also give advice on nutrition.
The following Western Province Rugby School of Excellence insert is brought to you by BestMed. Be active, be safe, be happy, be NutriWise, be fin fit.
BestMed have of course come on board there with the Western Province Rugby School of Excellence. That was your BestMed Western Province Rugby School of Excellence feature. Jerome, the Oaks must be smiling from ear to ear as a kid to be wearing the blue and white stripes.
Yeah, definitely, JP. I mean, for a lot of these youngsters, since they understand rugby, it's a dream for them to wear any Western Province kit. And now, I mean, it's a reality. Their dreams come true. And who knows? For a lot of them, their journey with Western Province will continue.
How much do they get looked after now?
Pretty much now, because it's almost like business end of the day now for them. So they go to this Coastal tournament, and then after the Coastal tournament they get capped as in the various teams.
Alright, Ish, you're obviously hoping to see some of these guys in your squads one of the later on.
Yeah, absolutely. This is the start of hopefully.
If not now already, considering how big they are.
Well, they're bigger than most of the club players.
Yeah.
Go ask them, what are they feeding them? No, I mean, this is where it all starts, and this is where the province really needs to identify the key players that are that, and we cannot afford to lose these guys to other provinces, and that's where Jerome comes in and the systems that is put in place to make sure that we capture these talented boys and make sure that they're going to represent the Stormers and hopefully the Springboks one day.
Right, so that was of course your BestMed Western Province Rugby School of Excellence insert. Congratulations to last week's score winner. Remember we said you can win yourself a case of score here on Cape Rugby TV. You win a case of score. Congratulations to Rustin Smith. Rustin walks away with a case of score energy drinks. One of the guys will be in touch with you shortly. All right, let's quickly take a look at the Western Province Rugby emerging team that is falling in under Jonathan van der Walt and Ishmael Dolly. Stephen Robinson from Durbel, Cameron Witten, Samir Davids, Tariq Allen, Wayron Losper, Charlton van Rasveld, Henko Sneeman, Peter Correa, Imran Hendricks, Madich Davids, Ryan Olivier, Ivor van der Merwe, and then of course Pro Mayizakiswe and Choco from Belhar. Wade Squire, Simon Askew, Ivor Panhazen, Lester Phillips, Patrick O'Brien, Christy van Niekerk, Conway Pretorius, and Sipandlema Dama. All right, two of those folks, incidentally, folks, two of those players in there were our man of the matches over the weekend, being Ryan Olivier and Patrick O'Brien. I think we made pretty good man of the match selections there. In the backs, of course, it's Freddie Miller, Niaz Johnson, Louis Nell, Dine Lisebwe Mayor, Dylan Freilink, Adri Klaassen, Dennis Cox, Jason Krill, Tony Taylor, Altus Momsen, Lubabablu Kuluba. We've interviewed him before.
Yeah.
In fact, Ardy Jacobs. Suwe Chibale, Lechli, Corley, Rian O'Neill, Daniel Erasmus, Inetemba Mpakwa, Joel Boyson, Fabian van der Vent, Alden Brandt, Elroy Brandt, Talib Johnson, Angela Nelson, Justin Phillies, Merlo Weich, Tian Swanepoel, Ramiz Osman, Mushtaqin Jappy, Craig Barry, and Etienne Swart. So those are your players that are heading into the emerging team. It's going to be a good team, I can tell you that. Some of those players, if I just look at some of those names there, the boys and boy from Belhar, Madich Davids from SK Warmers. He's got great future ahead of him, of himself. I'm sure he just needs to focus on the game, and we're going to see a star player there. But I look at Mashtakin Jappy at False Bay. He is absolutely blitzvinnig. And then a couple of the other names. I mean that Merlo Weich last year was the highest point scorer at the sevens. You know, some of the names that jump out for me are just Tony Taylor. He's been around for a while. What an absolute champion, Freddie Miller. What a team that emerging side is going to have. I mean, Jerome, you've got to be thrilled.
Yeah, definitely, JP. And as I said earlier on, we're blessed with all these talented players that we have. And also, there's another column, also almost another squad on the side who's currently in the Currie Cup squad out of the clubs, who's playing club rugby, but they're part of the Currie Cup squad. I think there's about 15 of that guys also.
Yeah.
So it's a massive thing, and it's a challenge for the coaches now. After the trial games, to pick the right team, and I'm looking forward to this year. I think we can really take the tournament, take the SA Cup, everything. So yeah.
Let's quickly look at the fixtures over the weekend. Then St George's are up against Pernille Villagers in Super League B. The A League is now on a break. Young Peoples are up against Belleville. It's Union Mill against Kraaifontein. Helderberg take on Makassar. Cullamore are up against Paarl in Super League C. Scottsdene, Lagunya, Langa, Wraithby, Elsies, and Franschhoek. While in the City League is Young Ideas and Busy Bees. And in the Southern League, Young Brothers, Rocklands, Noordelijkers, Bishop Lavers, Young Wesleys, and Eerste Rivier. And then, of course, in the Northern Leagues, Whistling Wales and All Saints, Khayelitsha and Imikawi, Delft and Stellenbosch Coronations, Atlantis take on Blakes. Right, folks, those are, of course, your fixtures over the weekend. There's going to be some fantastic games. Even with the break, there is still games carrying on in all the leagues, especially in the Paarl League as well. Ishmael Dali, would you like to take this opportunity to wish our Muslim members for Ramadan?
Absolutely. So, yeah, just to wish all the Muslims, not only the Muslim clubs, every single Muslim around the world, Ramadan Mubarak, and may this month be filled with love and prosperity, and may it be a joyous month to all.
Yeah, I love seeing the Facebook posts, the spirit during this month. I think it's just fantastic. So yes, our best wishes to all our Muslim clubs and viewers and fans, moms, dads, administrators, aunties and uncles, everybody, Ramadan Mubarak. Have yourself a blessed month. Jerome, I'm not sure where you're going over the weekend, probably to the Springbok Test match.
Yeah, Friday night to the club games.
Pop into Unimall.
Yeah. We'll leave it at that then, yeah.
Then the test on Saturday, and I think with the squad that Alistair choose, we might beat the island.
All right, Ishmael Dali, thank you for joining me on the show. We'll see you again hopefully next week, if not sooner than that.
Absolutely.
Well, not sooner than that, but true.
Thank you. Look forward to it.
Jerome, lekker genieten af je.
Thank you, JP.
There we go, everybody. That's a wrap of Cape Rugby TV. Have yourself a fantastic rugby weekend. We'll see you again next week. Same time, same place. Bye-bye.